Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to SRPC. We are glad to have you, whether you're with us on live stream or in the room. In fact, if you're in the room, would you give a shout out and a clap this morning? Yeah, yeah. Hey, it is a great day to worship the Lord, and we are glad that you've joined us in doing that. We begin a series today on the Ten Commandments. And I don't know what your take is on the Ten Commandments, but people can have different points of view. A lot of people think the commandments are just a set of rules that God gave because people have a tendency to be bad. Well, that's one way you can look at them. But the Ten Commandments are actually an incredible gift of God's grace to us. They point us to God's greater purpose for our lives and for the world. We're going to walk into that discovery today, so I hope that we fully engage with God's word as God's people, whether here or at home. Let's start by standing, and we invite you to stand at home too, and singing our first song of worship, which talks about the awesomeness of God. Let's go for it.
And together we sing. Glory.
often in his letters gives us the imagery of us being these sinners condemned to death, as if we're in a dungeon in the basement. And it's only by the mercy of God that Jesus comes and dies on that cross so that we can have what mercy is. Mercy is God's attitude of forgiveness in giving and not giving us what we deserve. And then as we stand before the throne of God, we have his grace, which is his attitude of blessing and benevolence in giving us what we do not deserve. Reading from Hebrews 4:16. Therefore, let us approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us at the proper time. That last part of that verse is in Greek, means in the nick of time. So in the nick of time, God offers us mercy and grace. Would you learn with us? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner. Now I'm not. With your blood you bought my freedom. Oh, hallelujah. For you for your holiness, but God, all it does is just show us how prone our hearts are to wander, how easily we are swayed by our culture to let go of our values, to start picking and choosing what we want in our Bibles. Oh God, forgive us this day for all of our defiance, God, for all the ways that we are not submitting to you and your will. Lord, we thank you that you pulled us out of that dungeon, even with all that sin, that you stood us before you, and that because of Christ, we have audience with you. We get to be recipients of your mercy, recipients of your grace. Hallelujah for the cross, Lord. We just pray now, Lord Jesus, that you would embed these truths deep in our hearts. It doesn't matter if we've been Christians for 10 minutes or 100 years, God, we need to be reminded of all that you have done for us. In remembrance of me, you said, just keep remembering. So God, we do that this morning. In the precious name of Jesus, amen.
Good morning, everyone. You can go ahead and have a seat. I'm Julie. I have the privilege and the joy of getting to work with our high school and junior high students, and this is a very special time of year. Our eighth graders just graduated recently, and all of our seniors, most of them, are graduating this next week. And so we wanted to pause and take a moment just to recognize this celebration in their lives and just all that the Lord has done in bringing them to this point. And a few of our seniors have submitted videos with messages for the congregation and our church family. So let's go ahead and take a look at those now.
Gilbertson. I've been a part of this church since I was born 18 years ago, and I have served in almost every aspect of the church. I've been homeschooled my entire life, and I'm taking classes from Las Positas Community College. My major is undeclared, but some topics that have piqued my interest are anthropology, humanities, research, and performing arts. Spending most of my life training in ballet has well equipped me to partake in SRPC's numerous theatrical productions. I will continue my academic studies at Las Positas to select a major, and I'm hoping to travel and that the ensuing adventures will both grow my life and amplify my perspective.
Hey SRPC, this is Lydia Wolford, and I'm graduating from San Ramon Valley High School this year, and I'm off to Pepperdine University in the fall to study business administration in hopes of becoming who knows what at this point, but hopefully we'll figure that out in the next few years. But I just wanted to take a minute to tell you how thankful I am, not only for all of the advice you've given me and lessons you have taught me, but thank you so much for showing me really what a relationship with God looks like and helping me grow in mine. I would not be in the place I am today without you, and so for that, I am forever grateful. I love you so much.
Hi, my name is Ellie Busboom, and I'm graduating from San Ramon Valley High School. In the fall, I'll be heading to Cuesta College to study elementary education in hopes to become a fifth grade teacher. I guess education runs in family. I just want to thank my SRPC family for being such a big part of my community and supporting me through my walk with Christ and just my walk in general. It's going to be so interesting not having you guys to fall back on or just going to church and stuff like that. So I'm really gonna miss my SRPC family, but I'll be back. But yeah, I just thank you guys for being there for me and just showing me what it really means to walk with Christ and what that looks like in your day-to-day life. So yeah, thank you.
There we go. I was just saying many of you probably remember them when they were this big and just the poise and the grace and the humor and just the maturity shines through in those videos. And we're just so proud and grateful of each of them and all of the seniors. So would you join me in a word of prayer? God, we just thank you for each of these lives. We thank you for their families, and we thank you, Lord, that you you have found us, that you came to this world for us. God, we just praise you for all that their lives hold, so for how far you've brought them, Lord, and all that they've accomplished. And yet, God, we know that everything we accomplish, it's what you have done too. And so, God, for the gift that they are to us and the gift that you have given them to be for this world, we just thank you and give you all the praise. And God, we thank you that you go ahead of them, that you go before them, and that you will guide them in every step. And Lord, for those students that still don't know you, God, we just thank you that you are the one who leaves the 99 to go after the one, and that, Lord, you are still writing their story and showing them your love and your grace. And God, we just pray for their hearts too as they step into this world. And God, we just pray a special blessing over their families, over their parents, that you would show them your mercy and give them your strength and your joy in this time of celebration and of change. God, thank you for their lives and for all you've done. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Julie. And what a great reminder of just how integral each person is in the life of this congregation, from the very youngest to the most senior member. We're all such a significant part of this family here. And blessings to you. Thanks for those videos. Those were so sweet. And an encouragement. And for those who weren't able to do videos or whatever, we pray your blessings over you too. And do know this, all you graduates, that as you go out, we look forward. Hopefully you'll tell us and let us be a part of your adventures. But know that you have a family here that is always loving you, supporting you, and praying for you. So don't forget that and engage that wherever your journey should lead. Hey, this is also obviously a special weekend in the life of our nation. It's Memorial Day weekend, and we have had a tradition here of just recognizing just the significance to us because the freedoms we have here, there's people who put their own flesh and blood on the line for that. And so just as a reminder to help us just remember what that is, if there are any here who have either served in the military, or you have family who've served, or maybe someone who actually gave their life for that, would you be willing to stand for just a moment? Is there anyone here? Or if you're at home, stand there too. Thank you so much. First of all, thank you. And second of all, you are a reminder. You're a physical, visual reminder that there were people like you who have given their all, their ultimate. And so we remember that on this day. And of course, remember the words of Jesus. It says, greater love has no one than this, that they would lay down their lives for their friends. And so we listen and remember that we as believers, too, are called to lay it down, which brings us to our offering this morning. We take a time to remember, even in our own ministries here. First of all, thank you to all of you who give and support the ministries of this church. But it's a reminder, too, that we are in another kind of battle. God calls us to a much greater battle. It's a spiritual battle. And this church, in our lives as believers, all are engaging that. And that's one that's everlasting. And so thank you to all of you who give and struggle in that battle. And even when we give and support, you are engaging that battle here in this valley and around the world, wherever God takes these ministries. So thank you for being part of that. So I want to take a time just to reflect on, first of all, the gifts God's given us, the gifts that he gives us to give. And maybe it's an opportunity to reflect on those who've gone before you, maybe loved ones you know who've given their lives for the freedoms we have. So let's pause and then I'll give a prayer of thanks. Lord, it's so awesome that you give us but one life to live on this earth.
And God, it is very sobering to think of those, Lord, who put themselves in harm's way to stop and confront the evils of this world. Father, we pray for those who are serving now, that you'd bless and protect them and help them to be ones that hold up good and righteousness in this world, Lord God. And we pray for those who are suffering, Lord, either from wounds or losses of family members or friends. God, we pray for their comfort on this day. And Lord God, we pray for, as we give our offerings today, we're reminded, Lord, that we too are called to lay our lives down for one another. Father, help us to have that spirit. Help us to have your heart, Jesus. So Lord, we do pray for the gifts that you have blessed us with and enable us to continue in ministry here, that they would be multiplied many times over, then more and more would see your great love, Jesus, that we will hear again today in our message. Thank you so much, Jesus, that you gave your life for us. In your name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Brother Mark.
Mike, how are you?
I'm doing good.
Good.
You know, I know often the Ten Commandments can just be a list on a wall. You know,
that
you can kind of, you know they're there and you kind of know them, but they can get pushed aside. And I'm excited for just digging deeper into it, what God's heart is through these and reminding us of that again. So thanks for leading us off in this.
I'm excited too. And thanks for talking about God's heart for it, because that really is where we're landing today. So
awesome.
It's a great, great help for us as we lean in. Hey, before we do, just a reminder to those of you who are watching online that we have an outline that's available to you. It always comes in the Saturday link. Even those who are gathered with us Sunday morning, feel free to bring that outline with you or refer to it on your phone or whatever during the message. I want to also just acknowledge Memorial Day, and we thank God for those who have served and, again, given the ultimate sacrifice of their lives for the freedoms that we enjoy today. We're so grateful for that, and many of us have family members and have perhaps served as well, and so we're grateful for you too. I want to also say how grateful I am for Julie and her student ministry team, who through a most crazy, crazy year has held those students together and found creative ways to meet and to gather. We are so blessed. And I know this has been a senior year or an eighth grade year like none other, and we hope there's not another like this. And yet we're so grateful for our seniors, our eighth grade grads, and all those who have endured and are now enjoying this success and the thrill of achievement in this way. So way to go, seniors and grads. We're so thankful for all of you. Hey, we are beginning a brand new series today called 10. We're taking a look at the 10 Commandments. And I guess I want to start the message with a question today. What's the point? When you think about the 10 Commandments, what is the point of the 10 Commandments? You know, there's some different ways that people might look at it. One perspective might be this. Well, the point of the 10 Commandments is to make people more civilized, right? The 10 Commandments came to an ancient people in an ancient world. Things were brutal. And so these commandments were a way to civilize people. That's a good thing, to make people more civilized. Another way to look at the commandments is, well, they're probably God's way to give people rules so they won't misbehave so much. I mean, if you look at people's lives, including our own, we tend to wreck our lives. And so God says, you know what? I'm going to give you rules. If you just follow these rules, you won't wreck your lives so much. Some people may look at the Ten Commandments as, well, you know, this is good advice for getting along with other people. Hey, if you don't lie, cheat, and steal, chances are you're going to have better relationships. And so the point of the Ten Commandments is to give some people some good advice about how to do relationships well. All of those actually are reasonable answers to the question, what's the point? But they're not nearly what the point of the Ten Commandments is. And so this summer, our goal is to find out what each of these commandments is really about, to unpack the commandments one by one and to discover what they meant, not only in their context, but why they matter today. 3,000 years later, imagine this, we're still talking about the Ten Commandments. They're still somewhat in play in our world. And what is it about them that still matters today, that has that sense of enduring quality, at least to our conscience, if not to our whole lives? And so as we take a look at this right from the very beginning, I want to share with you our big idea. If you worship with us regularly, you know the big idea is the thing that we want to take with us more than anything from the message on any given Sunday morning. And the big idea today, and it's important that we start like this when we're talking about the Ten Commandments, the big idea is this: grace is always God's first move. Grace is always God's first move. Now, here's the thing. When we come to the commandments, it's easy to think, okay, these are rules, and rules are to be obeyed, rules are to be followed, but they all come in this context of grace. Grace is always God's first move. If we don't understand that about the commandments, we mess ourselves up right away. We look at the commandments and we see, okay, they're rules. They're constraints in our lives. They're ways that God gets mad at us if we mess them up. They're threats for punishment if we disobey. But the commandments are all baked and based in grace. Grace is always, always God's first move. If we don't embrace that truth right from the get-go, especially when we look at the commandments, what happens is our relationship with God gets all mixed up and backwards. We build our relationship with God on things like guilt. We build our relationship with God on fear of doing the wrong thing. We build our relationship with God on performance. I've got to do the right thing. We build our relationship with God on the threat of punishment. Like, God is going to get me if I disobey the commandments. If we don't embrace the truth that grace is always God's first move, we get our relationship with God all mixed up and backwards. And you end up with a faith that says this: I have to obey God or else. And a lot of us live our lives like that. I mean, let's be honest. A lot of our motivation for faith, maybe when we were little kids and heard the story of faith and Jesus and the cross and all that, was, wow, I better be good or God's going to be mad. Right? And that's a terrible way to live your faith. So as we come to the Ten Commandments, we have to understand that grace is always God's first move, because if we don't, we end up in this cycle of performance or guilt or threat or fear. And that's never what God intends. Grace is always God's first move. So, let me show you the context today of the Ten Commandments, and that's all I'm going to do. We're not going to go through the commandments one by one. We'll do that starting next week. But today I want to give you the overview, the big picture, the context of the Ten Commandments. God and Moses had this amazing relationship. If you look in the Old Testament, the first five books of the Bible, you'll see God and Moses dialoguing over and over again. And in one particular place, in Exodus chapter 19, God and Moses are dialoguing. And God says, Moses, here's what I want you to help the people understand. Here's what I want them to know. You yourself, this is right before God gives the Ten Commandments, you yourself have seen what I did to Egypt and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Let's stop right there. God says, I want the people to know, to remember how I carried them on eagle's wings and brought them to myself. Now, does that sound like a taskmaster? Does that sound like someone with a whip? Does that sound like someone who's threatening to go after people that disobey? It sounds to me more like a love story. It sounds to me more like a love poem. Like, I'm gathering together. I'm carrying you up on eagle's wings. I'm calling you to myself. Those are words of love. Grace is always God's first move, and we see it before the commandments are given. Now, right on the cusp, Exodus chapter 20, of the Ten Commandments. Again, this is what God says to Moses, that he should tell the people. God spoke all these words. This is what Moses is to say. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. See, what God wants the people to know before he gives them this list of 10 things is, I am the God who rescued you. I'm the God who freed you. I'm the God who brought you to myself. I'm a God of grace and a God of rescue and a God of love. God didn't rescue people from slavery so he could put them in bondage in another way. That wasn't God's intent. But if we look at the Ten Commandments as rules to obey, what we see, or what we assume, or what we conclude, is that God was just swapping out their slavery to Egypt to slavery to him. That is not it at all. God didn't rescue people from slavery just to bring them into another form of bondage. Instead of being a list of rules, they're a sign of God's love. God wants people to embrace his grace and learn how to live and to thrive in all of their relationships. That's what the Ten Commandments are about. God wants to love his people and through them, love the world. That's a big deal. That's why Israel is there. God wants to love and bless them so they can love and bless the world. Here's what God says in Exodus chapter 19, verses 5 and 6. Now, if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations, you will be, watch, my treasured possession, my love. And although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests, a holy nation. These are the words you are to speak to the Israelites. God says, I want you to show the world what my love and my blessing is all about. And I'll help you do that through the commandments. The Ten Commandments, what they do is they continue God's commitment to love and bless the people of Israel, and they continue God's commitment to love and bless the world through them. God's people will in turn love and bless the world. Now that is a much grander purpose than a bunch of rules that you better obey or else God will get mad, right? It's a whole lot different than that. And along the way, through the commandments, we get to see not only God's bigger picture for the world, to love and bless people who will love and bless the world, but we get to see God's picture, bigger picture, better picture, grander vision for your life. God's bigger, better, and grander picture for my life. All of that comes through the commandments too. We don't have time to go through them all today, but let me just show you a little bit of what that looks like. First of all, the Ten Commandments help you know yourself better. God's bigger picture for your life comes through the commandments because they secure you in God's love for you. Here's what some of the commandments remind us of, that you don't have to be jealous. You don't have to be envious. You don't have to covet other people's success or their stuff. You don't have to do that. Why? Because you are enough. You are loved just as you are. Just where you are at your station in life, no matter what you have, no matter what your successes or your failures or your stuff or your not stuff is, you're loved by God right there. So you don't need to worry about being jealous or envious or coveting. See, that's your value in God's sight, independent of other people's success and other people's stuff. That is an incredible gift. It's like a, whew, I don't have to chase. I don't have to be in that race. Wow, what a gift. The commandments free you up also from having to measure your value by your work. Remember that commandment, remember the Sabbath and keep it holy? That command is God's provision for rest. What God says in that commandment is, I want a relationship with you, not production from you. And I'm going to prove that I want relationship with you over production from you by giving you a day of rest. 400 years of slavery for Israel in Egypt. You think they got a day off? Mm-mm. Not a chance. God says, I'm giving you a day a week because I'm about my relationship with you, not production from you. In fact, I'm so committed to this that you give your servants days off. You give your herds and your cattle, your animals, the earth, a day off. That's how much I value you and all that you have around you. They free you from having to measure your value by your work. That's an incredible gift. There's a bigger and there's a better picture and purpose for the world and for you within each of the commandments. And we're going to find that out as we go on through these weeks. Now, here's the thing. People don't think like that. You don't think like that. I don't think like that. So the commandments end up getting reduced to this list of rules. And here's the hook. Because they're rules from God, we actually try harder to obey them. Because we know that God gave them, we know they're even more important. We should try even harder to obey them. And listen, trying harder is a trap. Trying harder is a trap. You end up either self-righteous because you think you're doing so good, or filled with guilt because you know you're doing terrible. Trying harder is a trap. But you see, we hook ourselves into that trap because we think God gave these commandments, and so it's super important that I try hard to keep them. It's funny to see Moses and his development in his relationship with God and his relationship with the people. At the end of the book of Deuteronomy, Deuteronomy 29, 30, and 31, Moses gives this closing speech before he goes away and new leadership takes over. He's speaking to the Israelites, and he says this, look it. He goes, let me just be honest with you. I'm kind of netting it out. Like, it's three chapters, you can read it all, but I'm sort of netting it out. Here's what he says. Listen, you're going to say all the right things right now. You're going to make all the big promises. You're going to say, hey, we're totally in. We're doing this. But you know what? You're going to mess up. You're not going to be able to pull it off. And here's why. Because it's not a matter of trying harder. It's not a matter of keeping the rules. It's a matter of the heart. So what needs to happen, people, Moses says, is God needs to get at your heart. In fact, in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 6, he says this, the Lord your God will circumcise your hearts so that you may love him with all your heart and soul and live. Moses says, listen, don't try hard because you're going to mess up. Change your heart. Allow God to change your heart. That's where this whole thing is going to come from. Keeping the commandments is not about trying harder. Keeping the commandments is about a change of heart. Moses says that at the end of Deuteronomy, and guess what? He's spot on. He's right. Over and over again, the people try and fail, try and fail, try and fail, and their solve for that issue is to create more commands. And by the end of it all, there are 613 commands. And it's because they tried and failed and got more commands, tried and failed and got more commands, and they never dealt with their heart. So in the Old Testament, after Moses, a bunch of years after that, the prophets come along, and the prophets all point to the same thing. They say, you guys, stop trying harder. It's about your heart. Jeremiah, one of the great prophets in Israel, says this in chapter 31. We'll put it on the screen. This is the covenant. This is God. This is the covenant I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it where? On their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. It's about the heart. It's about the heart. Now, here's the thing. We're sitting here, we're New Testament Jesus people in the church, and there's a lot of stuff that we've been talking about Old Testament, and so the question naturally may come to you, okay, well, where does Jesus fit into all of this? I mean, isn't the Old Testament kind of like the Jewish story? And the New Testament with Jesus is the Christian story. So why don't we just sort of focus on Jesus and let the Old Testament Jewish story be the Jewish story and let the New Testament Jesus and Christian story be the Jesus and Christian story? And we ask ourselves that question, or at least think of that, why don't we just focus on Jesus? C.S. Lewis in his book, Mere Christianity, has this amazing analogy. He says, it's like this. He says, it's like the Old Testament is this great piece of music, this symphony. And you read through the Old Testament and you see all these wonderful parts of the symphony and you go, wow, this is really cool, this is really cool. But what is putting it all together? What is that big picture that sort of hangs it all together? Lewis goes on and says, when Jesus comes, he completes the picture. When Jesus comes, he completes the symphony. You find out that Jesus is the main theme of the symphony. And when you put Jesus in there, everything else from beginning to end ties together in Jesus. Jesus saw himself as the one who would continue and complete the story that began in the Old Testament. He saw himself as the one that would solve the heart problem. We keep defaulting to trying harder. Jesus comes to solve the heart problem. Let me tell you how he does it. He does it first through perfect obedience. Jesus is perfectly obedient to the law of God. In fact, in Matthew chapter 5, verse 17, here's what Jesus says. Don't think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. You see, Jesus showed us what a heart perfect in love for God and perfect in love for people looks like. Jesus solves the heart problem by being perfectly obedient to the law. He shows us what that looks like. Once Jesus was asked by someone, okay, what's your take on the commands? Which is the greatest commandment? And here's what Jesus said. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. And Jesus did that. Jesus showed us what that looked like, to love God perfectly and to love people perfectly. He showed us perfect obedience, and that's how he helped solve our heart problem. Jesus also solves the heart problem with grace. Remember, grace is always God's first move, and we see that in Jesus again. The cross of Jesus is our place of grace. At the cross, Jesus absorbs the consequences of every hard heart, including yours, including mine. Jesus does that at the cross. He absorbs it all. It's a place of grace for us. That's how Jesus solves the heart problem. And third, Jesus solves our heart problem by giving us the Holy Spirit. If you're a follower of Jesus, here's what you know about yourself. God's Spirit lives within you. God's Spirit lives in your heart and empowers you to live a life of love for God and love for other people. In fact, the Bible talks about this thing called the fruit of God's Spirit, what God's Spirit does inside of you all over time, right? The fruit of the Spirit. And those of us who've hung out in church for a while, we know about the fruit of the Spirit. The Bible says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That's what God's Spirit inside of us does through us over time. Let me tell you something. You allow God to do that in your life, and you've got the Ten Commandments down cold. I mean, you don't have to memorize them. You don't have to go through them every day. You just live a life of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. You have nailed the commandments. And that's all about God's Spirit within you, producing that kind of fruit. You see, Jesus solves the heart problem by giving us his Holy Spirit. He lives a perfect life. He dies on the cross. He gives us the Holy Spirit. All of that happens because of Jesus. See, Jesus is that missing piece of the symphony, that main thing that holds everything and brings everything together. That's why Romans 3 in the Bible says this, but now apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through working really, really hard. This righteousness is given by trying as hard as you can to make God happy. This righteousness is not any of that. This righteousness comes through faith in Jesus Christ. It comes by letting Jesus do what only Jesus can do. Live that perfect life that you can never live. Let grace fill yours and empower you with his Spirit. The righteousness, the keeping of the law, comes through Jesus. It's all about him. So we're going to toggle back and forth between the Old Testament, the book of Exodus, the Ten Commandments, and Jesus all the way throughout this series, because we always want to come back to Jesus, because it's all about him, to help us do that. So today, as we begin this series on the Ten Commandments, we start with Jesus. He is the place of grace. And as we go through the commandments each week, please, please know this. It is not about trying harder to do better. It is not about making you feel guilty for what you failed to do. It is not about raising the bar of God's expectation in your life and then shooting as high and as hard as you can to make the grade. It's not about that. It's about a heart change. And only Jesus can change your heart. Will you pray with me? God, as we think about the commandments, our human instincts kick in. The instinct to try harder. The instinct to do better. The instinct to reach higher. The instinct to perform better. It's just where we go. And I pray this morning that you would forgive us for reducing your great purposes for our lives and for the world to a set of rules that we have to obey or else. Lord, forgive us for missing your heart in the middle of it all and leaving our heart far behind as we try harder to obey. God, we need your help. We need your help to understand the bigger purpose for our lives. We need your help to embrace grace. We need your help to walk by your Spirit. And so on the threshold of this series, we say both thank you and help. We want our hearts to be changed. So day by day this week and week by week through the series, I pray that we would remember that your first move is always grace. And your greatest dream and desire for us is for a changed heart. Out of that, everything flows. So thank you, Lord, for the gift of your word, your will, your commandments. And thank you for your grace. It's in Jesus that we pray. Amen. Our closing song today is actually one of our favorites, I think, here at SRPC. It's Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. And so these wonderful words that are bedrocks in that Amazing Grace song, you're going to get the chance to sing those. And then this whole idea of my chains are gone, I've been set free. Right? That's the grace of Jesus breaking through our lives and getting after our hearts, because that's where it all happens. Would you stand both at home and in here in our sanctuary? Let's sing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone.
beautiful. Thank you. Wow. What's so awesome too to me is just to think of that same spirit you talked about, Mark, is moving right now. Mm-hmm. And hopefully you've been touched in some way and you carry that with you through this week. Hey, just want to close with just a few reminders. Thank you to so many of you who have already completed the survey that we've been doing as a church. If you haven't heard about it, go online, check the emails, but it's a survey we're doing just to kind of follow our journey here, see how we're doing, and to get feedback from you. If you haven't done it, though, I really encourage you to do that. Check your emails, just hit the button. It does take a commitment. It's about 30 minutes or so. Mm-hmm. But one thing that's interesting, especially if you've been here for a while, it takes you back down the journey mm-hmm. a little bit, reflecting on these years. But if you're brand new, we want to hear from you too. Mm-hmm. We want to hear from everybody. That's how the survey actually really has meaning, mm-hmm. the more people that take it. So thank you, and don't forget about that. Yeah. Hey, also don't forget about Shepherd's Gate. This is a ministry partner we have that is a shelter for women and often their children too, who are needing help. They've come out of a difficult situation, and we get to bless them by providing some goods for a welcome kit. And so we're collecting kind of small shampoos, soaps, lotions, that kind of thing. We're going to collect them on June 13th right here. You can bring them earlier if you want. You can bring them next week, but on the 13th will be a final day. And then we'll take them over and just be a blessing to these people who are in a time of crisis. And finally, we've kind of had it in our rhythm to do on Communion Sundays, the first Sunday of the month, an outdoor service. We're not going to do that. We're going to meet in here, climate controlled. Wonderful. Yes. No outdoor service in June so far. Unless something right. happens, right? Yeah. You never know. Anyway, that's it. Mark, send
all
us
right.
home.
Fantastic. Hey, listen, I usually have kind of a short, brief word as a benediction, but I just want to, today in our benediction, pray these words over us as a church, both here and at home. So these are the words of the prophet Jeremiah about our hearts, and they're words that come from the Lord. So would you close your eyes and let me just allow the Lord to speak to you as I read these words. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand and led them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, know the Lord, because they all will know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wickedness and remember their sins no more. That's God's word to you today. Amen. Have a great week. We'll see you soon.